from Kecoughtan High School in Hampton. WHCS Cable Channel 5 presents Peninsula District Girls Basketball. The Hampton Crabbers visiting the Kecoughtan Warriors. Good evening, everybody. I'm Tim Cole along with Bob Hintz. We welcome you to Kecoughtan High School for this battle between the Kecoughtan Warriors at 3-9 and the Lady Crabbers at 3-10. Let's go across the court, middle of the court, I guess you'd say, as Bob Hintz has head coach Lester Sapp.
Lester, you had a great job last night in a win that depended on defense.
Mm-hmm. We got a tremendous showing last night from Ebony Copeland, Felicia Kidd, and LaTanya Sherman on Heritage Big Girl. She's 6'3". She plays real well inside. And every time she turned around, we had two and three people on her to deny her the ball. And we were very lucky it worked out well for us. We were very physical last night. Mentally, we were up. I just hope we don't go from the high to the low tonight. We need to keep this intensity.
Well, this team you're playing tonight, same record. So it's very important to get a leg up, so to speak.
Right. Paula's done a tremendous job with her girls. The fundamentals are very sound. The last time we played them, that's what beat us, was fundamentals.
Okay.
They outplayed us, they hustled us, and, you know, we were lucky just to be in the gym there for a while.
Well, listen, good luck to you tonight. You're home, and hope you come back with a winner.
Well, we hope so. Like Sweet Pea Whitaker said last night, bring the apple to the teacher.
Okay. All right, let's go back over to Tim.
All right, thank you. And we got our microphone problem solved there after a moment. And last night, as Bob was talking with Lester Sapp, he was talking, of course, about the Kecoughtan Warriors beating Heritage 49-32 here at Kecoughtan High School. So a good victory last night for Lester Sapp's Lady Warriors. Let's go back to Bob. He has head coach Paula Hines of the Lady Crabbers.
Well, Paula, the first time you played this team, tremendous on the fundamentals, Coach Sapp said, that you guys just out hustling and everything. They're a different team now than when you played them the first time.
Oh, yes, definitely. And they're going to be after us, and we're just going to have to maintain and play our game and be able to adapt to anything that they might do and come out winning.
Okay, now, do you like more of an up-tempo than a walk the ball up the court, or how do you play?
Well, that depends on your personnel, and also depends on what's happening in the game. There are times when you need to slow it down. Say, like, in the second quarter, in the fourth quarter, if we're ahead, we want to protect our lead, we might have to pull a delay game. But most of the time, yeah, we like to press, we like to run.
Good for you. Well, good luck to you tonight.
Thank you.
Good enough. Let's go back over to Tim.
All right, thank you. Paula Hines, the head coach of the Lady Crabbers, her squad with a 3-10 record to date. And I'm not sure exactly why Lester Sapp's squad apparently has one less game, as they are sitting with a 3-9 record coming into this game. And in any event, the two teams with similar records, of course, starting to feel like Kecoughtan High School is my home away from home, Bob.
Well, we've been here three nights in a row, or three telecasts in a row, and we really appreciate all the effort that Leonard Thomas, the AD here, gives us. And of course, we enjoy doing basketball, but this gym is smaller, and you really get a sense of being right up on with the players. So it really makes it exciting.
So the Kecoughtan Warriors will be hosting Hampton. We'll be set for the starting lineups here in just a moment. As our good friend, or at least my good friend, I don't know if he's still your friend or not, Buddy Denton.
Well, Buddy still likes me.
All right, let's give you the starting lineup. First of all, number 33 for the Lady Crabbers, that's Akia Smith. Number 40 is Ebony Jackson. Number 24 is Crystal Woods. Felicia Reynolds, one of the co-captains. And the other co-captain, Monica Jackson, number 21. And that rounds out the starting lineup for the Lady Crabbers, coached by Paula Hines.
And there you see the Lady Crabber lineup, Tim. This is not a very big team in personnel, but she has about seven depth. She can go two to three on her bench. Really a big advantage. Kecoughtan is hurting in the depth department.
First lady to be introduced for the Kecoughtan Warriors, number 33, Felicia Kidd, who had a nice big hug for Paula Hines. Number 11, Ebony Copeland, with a hug as well. Like to see that. Number 45, Tonya Sherman, who had a great game last time we saw her play against the Lady Bruins.
Yes, in fact, she ended up with the player of the game.
Eola Lewis, number 31. And rounding out the starting five, number 23 is Kiona Gales. And there you see the starting five for Leicester Saps, Lady Warriors, with a 3-10 record. And we've mentioned it before, we don't want to beat it to death, but I believe Leicester would have had a much better record at this point in the season without all the injuries that his squad has suffered. And he's the first one to tell you that that's not an excuse. That's the way it is. You play with injuries, but it's been tough.
It really is. As you see our officials there,
Robert Dixon will be the gentleman tossing the ball for the only jump ball in the contest, and Robert Limus is the umpire tonight.
Well, they got two good first names.
That's right, Robert.
Tim, one thing that has happened with these Lady Warriors is other players have had to play positions that they normally wouldn't have, and they are getting better as the season goes along, and they're also getting experience in that, so it's going to help the Kickatan program in the long run.
All right, we're set to go as Sherman will jump against Jackson, and it's easily controlled by the Kickatan Warriors, homestanding Warriors in the white uniforms with the green stripes and numerals.
And Hampton comes right out immediately in a 2-3 zone. They want to try to keep the ball out of Sherman's hands, since she's so much taller than anybody else, and we got a steal right off the bat.
And the Crabbers will bring it down in the lane, knocked out of bounds. It'll belong to the Kickatan, excuse me, to the Hampton Crabbers.
Well, it was a good job that time of Tonya, I'm sorry, of Sherman getting back into the passing lane to knock that ball out of bounds. It would have been an easy two for the Crabbers.
8-minute quarters in high school basketball. There is no shot clock. The team must get the ball across the midcourt 10-second line. That's a three-point attempt off the mark, rebounded by the Crabbers, and stolen on the baseline. Good job on defense, and then a reach-in foul, and that'll be the first one against the Crabbers. That'll be against Monica Jackson, number 21.
Tim, next time down the court, check out what the Kickatan Warriors are doing. They're playing a box and one. They got four ladies that are playing a zone and one chaser that's chasing the leading scorer and the ball handler of the Lady Crabbers, trying to throw off their rhythm and so they can't get into their offensive sets.
Wood Funeral Home with the funeral director Richard Pulley is our corporate sponsor here in the first quarter. Also on duty at the Wood Funeral Home, John Ware and Brian Wood. So the turnover gives the ball back to the Lady Crabbers. No score here. We're just in the first minute. Shot from outside goes over the backboard, out of bounds. It'll belong to the Warriors. You and I will be doing a midweek game this coming week down in Phoebus High School.
Yes.
First visit away from my home from homes here at Kickatan.
And first chance we will have to catch the Hampton Crabbers other than tonight, but we get to see the Hampton three times, as we get to see all the schools three times, but Hampton, of course, played less games to this point because of the football schedule, and they're starting to pick up now. This is the only game scheduled tonight.
So we'll
in the district, I'm sorry.
We'll have Phoebus and Hampton Tuesday night, the 28th. We invite you to come out in person, see the game, support your favorite team. Tie up, and the possession arrow will give the ball over to the Lady Crabbers. All right, the Warriors on defense now. Well, we'll see that box and one you were talking about.
All right, number 23 for the Crabbers, Gales, is shadowing number 21, Monica Jackson, all over the court. She's just like a shadow. She's going to go wherever Jackson goes, so goes Gales.
You said she's a Crabber. Gales is, yeah. Gales, of course, is the Warrior.
Oh, nice move.
Did not go, batted around, and saved on the baseline, but saved to a Crabber. And back come the Lady Crabbers with 2 minutes gone here in the contest and still no score.
And that was Ebony Copeland, Tim, that made that great move inside.
From outside, the first basket is recorded by Monica Jackson.
That is one reason that they're playing the box and one, but you notice on a score, right into a 2-1-2 trap.
And a travel. So the
causes a turnover, Tim.
Defense gets the ball back.
That's what you want your trap to do. Cause some turnovers, get some easy baskets off your defense. But you can't get in it if you don't score any points. And it was, what, almost three and a half minutes gone before they had a score. Or two and a half, I'm sorry.
From the free throw line, the shot isn't down and it's rebounded, I should say, by the Warriors. That is number 33, Felicia Kidd, who has played extremely well for Lester Sapp.
She really has. She's basically one of the leaders.
Warriors trying to work it down low, turn it over.
Well, they tried passing in, and it's a tough pass, and it was just too low to handle for Sherman.
And a hot pass off the hands of number 24, Crystal Woods. She couldn't handle the bullet.
Yeah, like Felicia Reynolds really put some mustard on that pass.
Looked like a Brett Favre 20-yard pass. I got football on my mind.
I hear you. Big game tomorrow.
Super Bowl. All right, so the Warriors now looking to tie or go ahead. Tough Hampton defense is preventing them from getting very close inside. We have a foul on number 12. That's Felicia Reynolds as she bumped the shooter, and that'll get two shots.
Well, and if you remember since the opening tip-off, Tim, that's only the second shot that the Crabbers have gotten. They have turned the ball over without getting a shot, and of course that makes the coach very concerned because you don't shoot, you can't score. Tim, we will pick a player of the game from both teams tonight, and each of those players will receive a plaque and a t-shirt. The plaque comes from Buckwalter Engraving, which is located at Kickatan Road. For all your engraving needs, contact Jim at 723-6067. Dave Buckwalter is the owner.
So Lewis hits the second after missing the first, and our score now 2-1.
And the shirt comes from the Island of Hardware and Sporting Goods located in Pocosin. They can meet all your sports needs with a full line of athletic goods, both equipment and uniforms, plus screen printing. Call Dave Chubb at 868-8467. John Roberts is owner.
Awkward off-balance shot forced up by the Warriors. Rebound is loose and it's controlled by the Crabbers.
The Crabbers have got three or four young ladies around that basket for defensive rebounds. They're not letting the Kickatan Warriors get but one shot.
Sherman with the rebound. So to say each team is cold would be to understate the fact. We've played half of the first quarter and our score is 2-1. Warriors again get it at the free throw line to Copeland. Now this is Felicia Kidd on the baseline, and she stepped on the baseline. Good defense caused that turnover.
Well, it's a lot of people think a zone is passive. Paula Hines got her Lady Crabbers playing a very aggressive 2-3 zone, Tim. They're right in the face of the ball handler as soon as they get it.
For three, no. Loose ball, battle four, and let's see who comes up with it. The Warriors have it. They've got a player in the free throw lane, but it's stolen by the Crabbers. Back comes Hampton, and a foul is called against number 23, Gales.
A nice job of Monica Jackson to control the ball and really put pressure on Jackson that time because she was going to take it in for the shot.
A chance to watch this again. Coming right at you. And right there, you saw it.
She really put her hand right on it. Good camera work. That's Ron Baton on that sideline camera.
So Monica Jackson, with the only points for the Lady Crabbers, will get a chance at the free throw line with two attempts. There you see a good look at Monica. And she hits the first. In the ball game for the Lady Crabbers, Linda Cruz comes in. She replaces Ebony Jackson.
Linda's transferred in from Alaska. Last year she played on a state championship team up in Alaska. She's a senior. And of course, you change teams, you change philosophies, you change offensive, defensive, and it's puts a little pressure on the young lady, but she's responding.
Ball is knocked out of bounds, but it still belongs to the Lady Crabbers. 3-1 in favor of Hampton. Knocked out of bounds by the Crabbers, so it'll go over to the Warriors. Good defense.
Well, that was Ebony Copeland, Tim. She knocked the ball down and hit it off the leg. You see a good shot of Lester Sapp.
There's a foul in the backcourt. That'll be on number 12, Reynolds, her second.
Can't throw that knee out there as much as you want to, and you say, well, if I take it out just a little. And, of course, as soon as you do, the official looking right at you.
We'll see the replay just the very end of it. You saw the contact and the foul. Kidd's shot is too strong. Sherman rebounds. No good. But Sherman gets another one. Still no good. She got a second and third chance. Her teammate tried to save it on the baseline. Kidd stepped on the line. And it'll go over to the Lady Crabbers.
Well, that was the first multiple rebounds that the Crabbers have gotten, but they didn't get the putback.
For three, no good. And again, Sherman, tallest lady on the court, and showing her good rebounding abilities. You know, as we mentioned last time we were here, being the tallest doesn't always give you the advantage. You have to have the timing, and she's done a good job of working on that.
And not only that, Tim, but when she gets the rebound, she keeps the ball in the air. She doesn't bring it down low where a smaller player can tie her up.
Ebony Copeland with a nice move to the basket. Didn't get the ball to go down, but she'll get a couple of shots. Fouled in the act of shooting.
We've talked about Coach Sapp. We want to mention his assistants, Phil Richardson and Jerome Bird. And, of course, you saw Paula Hines on the screen. She's assisted by... What do you got? Is it Chuck Gary and Darnell Barnett, I believe it is.
I believe you're right. One out of two for Copeland. Warriors had the rebound but gave it away. Left side shot off the mark. Rebound and a shot blocked by Sherman. Sherman, she goes down hard as she hit the back of her head.
Did.
Oh, she's okay. I think she's more mad at herself than anything. What a nice job of hustling.
Well,
Sherman.
You can't fault either one of these teams for not hustling after the ball.
Sherman really took a spill. See if we can watch the very tail end of this. You're going to see her get the rebound here and then.
Oh, that was a block?
Yeah, and then down the court, and she went down heavily. Boom, right there at the end of your picture. Back to the live action. The shot goes down.
Goberson. Yes, right. Kim came in, and she's got a nice shot. Against a zone that if they let her have an open area, she's going to bury it. And that gives the Warriors their first lead.
With that basket, it makes it 4-3 with 2:01 left here in the first period. The first basket of the first period for the Warriors as they had gotten their other 2 points from the free throw line. Earlier this afternoon, before this game, the JV girls battled and the Hampton Crabbers were victorious 69-41 in that contest. Don't have the score of the JV boys game, which we played earlier today. Apologize for not having that for you. There you see one of Hampton's finest.
That's exactly what he said.
He knows. I don't know that gentleman's name. I've seen him.
I see him all the time. But I smile and say hi to him.
That's right.
They got a place down there where you can sign up to shoot 3-point shot, Tim. I thought you'd sign up.
I wouldn't be able to. I can't even shoot a layup, let alone a 3-pointer. Did watch on one of the cable networks that had their plays of the week and showed a guy somewhere out west hitting one from half court for some big bucks.
Oh, great.
But, yeah, I'm just lucky that I couldn't even hit a wall with the ball. Baseline, nice drive and a bucket for number 34, Linda Cruz.
Well, good now that zone, that box is supposed to shift down and not allow the young lady to drive. Baseline, what we have, a foul?
Yeah, a reach-in foul is going to be whistled down on Monica Jackson. That's her second. Going to get a substitution now as Tanisha Thomas is going to come in the game, and she'll replace Monica Jackson. Maybe the third. We've talked about this before, and I don't want to belabor it, but it was hard for us to pick up who the fouls are called on. I have two on Jackson. She may well have three. In any event, she is pulled out of the game very quickly after picking up that foul. And we've got a foul on the baseline, a blocking foul, and that's going to be on Linda Cruz, number 34.
Tim, Monica Jackson is the young lady that they were playing the box and won. Now she is out. I look for Kickatan to go back to a basic 2-3 defense. We'll see next time down the court if that's what they do.
Felicia Kidd will step to the free throw line, her first chance at the charity stripe tonight.
And they're in the bonus already.
Hampton has committed a number of fouls here in the first period, and Kidd makes them pay with the front end of the 1-1. Second as well, so that gives the lead back to the Lady Warriors.
And they've jumped out into a full court press, but nobody
back. Oh, but she couldn't hold on. She took an extra step.
Well, and she had to get under control, but what a great job, because nobody was deep on that press.
Alicia Kidd,
look at Sapp, and Sapp is upset.
And Sherman knocks the inbounds pass away. So the good hands folks are alive and well in Kickatan. The defense causing Hampton some problems. And again, it's stolen by Gulbranson. But that was set up by Sherman knocking the ball to her.
Both times she got her hand on. She is so tall that they forget that not only she's 6'1", but when she puts her hands up, she's more like 7 foot or more.
She's got real long arms, which is very much to her benefit. Warriors are able to break the timeline, and then we've got a travel, yes. So the Warriors got it across the timeline, and again, the defense caused the tie-up and caused the feet to shuffle.
Well, and it's a little, they're playing just a little bit out of control. Again, nobody is back. They called traveling, Tim. She may have had a little help.
Yes. That pushed pretty clearly there, but the shuffling of the feet is what was detected. 1:05 to go in the first period. It's 6-5 in favor of Kickatan. They've got the ball again. Top of the key. Copeland tied up, and the possession arrow will give the ball back to the Warriors.
Well, as soon as they drop that ball into Copeland, and Kickatan is trying to play a high-low, getting the ball at the foul line, and she's turning around either driving or trying to get the ball to Kidd or Sherman underneath, and is Hampton doing a great job of not allowing them to get that pass in there.
Sherman, as the Warriors hit the offensive board nicely.
That's two offensive rebounds they got that time.
That foul is charged to Linda Cruz, number 34, her second. And that'll bring two shots for Tonya Sherman. The chance to give her team their biggest lead of the night. The rim with the first one. She misses both, but a fortunate break for the Warriors. The ball is knocked out of bounds on the loose ball by Hampton. So the Warriors get it back. Felicia Kidd will chase it down. This is Gales to Gulbranson. Gulbranson was the intended recipient of the pass, and it was stolen momentarily, but she couldn't hold on to it. That was Felicia Reynolds on the defense for Hampton. 33 seconds remaining in the first period. Kickatan and Hampton doing battle. Kidd is fouled. It's another 1-1 situation coming up.
That was a tough pass she was trying to make, but it did get through. And Sherman right up and put it in, but of course the foul nullified the basket, but great job of passing inside interior by the Lady Warriors, really putting the pressure on the Crabbers underneath and put them, get them a lot of foul trouble. Could hurt them later on in the second half.
Well, Felicia Kidd now, who is 3 for 3 from the free throw line. And it's a 2-point lead for the Warriors. So as sure as I mentioned her perfect free throws, she misses one.
The broadcaster curse.
17 seconds to go in the first. Grabbers off the glass, no good. And a battle for the ball tied up, and it'll still belong to the Lady Crabbers. 10 seconds to go. Down low, stolen, but on the baseline was Gales.
Oh, she's playing a good job defensively in there tonight.
Cruz shot no good, and the rebound comes to the Warriors, and the buzzer will sound to end the first period. So a seesaw battle saw the Crabbers leading for the better part of the early part of the period, but then the Warriors have taken the lead, and they lead 7-5 after the first 8 minutes.
Again, let me let the fans know that we will play a pick of the game.
Or pick a play.
Yeah, something like that. We will pick a player of the game for both of these teams. And, of course, they will receive a plaque and a shirt. Plaque comes from Buckwalter Engraving, located at Kickatan Road. Dave Buckwalter's owner. Call 723-6067. And the T-shirt comes from the Islander Hardware and Sporting Goods, located in Pocosin. Call Dave Chubb at 868-8467.
You saw a little bit of the replay of the first period. There's some of the fans enjoying food in the gym where it has clearly marked on the doors, no food or drink allowed.
Yeah, and I noticed you come in with a drink.
Hey, I asked.
Hey, there's a new fan.
They said, what does it matter? So I said, I'll bring my drink in here too. All right, we've got some new faces.
There you go. She's not sure what was going on.
Angie Sanders has checked in along with Carolyn Babalola of the Warriors. So a new backcourt tandem, almost on the timeline. This is Babalola, and she traveled. She had a little help. Her defender for Hampton reached in and caused her to momentarily fumble the ball, and that caused her to shuffle her feet. So many of these turnovers are as a result of the defense. It's not simply a matter of poor play on the part of the offensive team by any means.
That's a good point.
Turnovers are a very deceptive statistic. Rebound by Kidd. She finds Copeland. Copeland almost tied up in the backcourt.
Wow, almost fouled.
Yep. Almost mugged. Sherman finds Copeland. Copeland will force it up. No good. Offensive stick back is good by Felicia Kidd.
And Kidd was in the right place. That weak side rebound, very important to get good position.
And stolen by Copeland. Did she hold on to it? No. It's regained by the Crabbers. Stuffed by Sherman. And then we've got 3 seconds long in the lane.
Well, Hampton is trying to pick up the tempo a little bit. And they are, but they're not getting the shots that they want.
Biggest lead of the ball game, 4-point lead now for the homestanding Warriors. Sanders has picked up a three-quarters court, as is Babalola. She drives the baseline, puts up a shot. It's off the mark and rebounded by the Crabbers, stolen by the Warriors for just a moment. Back to the Lady Crabbers, and they throw it away.
And that was a good pass. What happened was the Lady Crabbers stopped to rebound, not looking for the pass.
Look at Paula Hines pointing to her head. She says, think, ladies, think.
Well, and they're pressing full court, man to man, and then they're doubling up every chance they get. In fact, it's like a 1-2-2 trap.
Sherman, the Hampton Crabber, holding her eye, having caught a pretty sharp elbow on that rebound, and still kind of rubbing her eye as they head back down the court. That's Weeks underneath the basket, and they can't get it to her. She's having kind of a tough second period right now. She looks a little miffed. Open is Sherman. Sherman off the glass, in and out. Offensive rebound, no good. And back come the Lady Crabbers. A hectic pace right now, and this one is stolen by Kidd. There you see it from the floor angle of our cameraman, Ron Baton. Now above, Susie Bowers got the shot. Knocked out of bounds. Got Nathaniel Braxton, Susie Bowers, and Ron ESPN Baton working the cameras for us tonight in the van. Bianca Petaway working the graphics. Bev Penn on the instant replay. And, of course, our director, producer, and vice president of Channel 5. Scotty Bowers.
You just gave him a raise or just give him another title?
Just a title.
Okay.
Don't want to have any misunderstanding about that. Back come the Warriors. 5:33 left in the first half.
And the Crabbers are in a 1-2-2 zone when they drop back. They just extend that 1-2-2 zone into a trap, and then they drop back into it when they get the ball gets across half court.
Substitutions for the Warriors. And now a timeout has been called with 5:26 remaining in the first half.
Did you get who that foul was on? Was that a foul?
No, it wasn't a foul. It was a tie-up. So they had the possession arrow. And there you see Lester Sapp as he addresses his Lady Warriors to discuss the strategy. And again, we remind you that we'll also have the boys' contest between these two schools. That will be coming up here on Channel 5 as well. As the Kingitan Warriors, there you see Susie Bowers. Warriors looking for their initial victory of the season. As we've said, well, we said a couple of weeks ago they were the best 0-10 team. I'd say now they're the best 0-12 team in high school basketball. Rebus Conrad and Mr. Braxton doing his usual superb effort.
He said he's not moving much, but he said such a beautiful day today, but there was no rain when he got up, so he must have got up late.
It rained last night out there and early this morning.
Man, did you hear the thunder?
Yeah. Whew. Is this the strangest January weather you've seen in a while? I'm here, didn't even wear a jacket to the game tonight.
And tonight it's going to get down into the 30s.
I got my jacket behind me, but I didn't wear it.
You didn't need it.
Beautiful weather. We'll pay for this in February, I guarantee you. And we've got a double dribble call, so the turnover gives it back to the Warriors. We've had just one basket scored here in the first 2 minutes and 45 seconds of the second period. Been a very low-scoring contest. 9-5 with a little more than 5 minutes to go in the half, and we've got a foul in the lane.
I tell you, when Copeland gets the ball, Tim, she knows what to do with it. She turns to go strong to the basket, and the only way that the Crabbers have stopped her is to reach in and slap her and either knock the ball away or foul her.
Got some more new faces on the floor now. Eileen Swisher and number 13, Talia Baum. They are both in for the Lady Warriors. So Lester Sapp not hesitating to go deep to the bench as his young Warrior team is playing tough in spite of all the injuries they've had to key players. And now their biggest lead of the game, 10-5. And a chance for Ebony Copeland to increase that lead here with a second free throw. And it doesn't stay down. So back come the Lady Crabbers, who really have not gotten into any kind of rhythm here. They've kind of taken some unusual shots, a lot of 3 points and deep twos. Blocked by Copeland.
Tim, a lot of that may be because of that defense of the Hampton, Warriors came out of that box and one, kind of disrupts the flow, and they haven't got back into it. And, of course, number 21, Monica Jackson, who is probably their quarterback on the court, is sitting over on the bench with at least two fouls.
She may have picked up her third, because I would have thought she'd be back in there by now with being the leading scorer, but if, in fact, she has three, and that's likely to be the case, Paula Hines cannot afford for her to pick up her fourth here in the first half. Loose ball is is battled for and finally controlled, but then thrown away by the Warriors. So Reynolds will inbounds and gets it right back from Thomas. Now this is Thomas, looks down low, and we've got a foul over the shoulder. That one's gonna go against, I believe they call that a number 45, Sherman. That is a player control foul, as the Warriors have not committed the necessary number 4 on the bonus, and the Crabbers can't control it. Revis Conrad just coming into the gymnasium here with...
And if you look down at the other door, in came Walter Brown.
Yeah, they've been out in the parking lot talking about the game.
I don't think so.
I don't think so either. Stolen. Weeks had it, and she and Sherman tangled up, and Weeks is again rather upset with the lack of a call. I think she might have had some point there. She was knocked around pretty strongly on the play and did not get a whistle.
And that's not the first time she's been knocked around tonight. You're right, she is really taking, there's a good shot of Walter Brow, the head man for the Crabber boys team.
Miss Weeks just gave the nastiest scowl to the referee. she walked by and she scowled at him like, are you not watching the same game I'm playing? She didn't say that, but she had that look on her face.
You think she had a little body language?
Yeah. Looks could kill. The referee just got shot. 10-5 with 3.5 minutes in the first half to go. The physical aspect of the game picking up here. Sherman double teamed and a reach in. Oh, they're going to call a flagrant foul.
Oh, they are?
Well, what's the crosses of the arms? That's...
He's doing this. You got to hold him above your head, though, to give it.
I was going to say, because that was a flagrant foul. I don't see it. No. So.
Well, Scotty thought he was doing the Macarena.
He was doing the Green Bay Arena. The Pack Arena is what it's called. The Pack Arena. Have you heard that yet?
No, I can imagine.
Oh, yeah. Well,
I've stayed away from that hype.
Same tune, different song. Sherman. Hype? You think there's a hype with the Super Bowl?
Geez. 2 weeks, and you start asking questions like they asked Chris Slade from, Play the Tab, to ask him, what do your family eat before you play? I mean, that's getting really ridiculous. You got to ask what the players' parents eat before a ball game.
I think the 2 weeks between the game is much too long. I think she played the week after the championship game. Get it on. They did that before, They do that when the schedule allows or permits them to do so. Otherwise, they drag that thing out for 2 weeks.
Well, I see one of our officials over there, Bill Wessels, is a young man, goes to the same barber you do over there in the corner.
Bill. He had a comment about your commentary on him last time.
Oh! Well, that's because he missed that three-point shot. And no way, that was you. You're the one that said the foot was on the line, Tim.
I told him it was you. He believed me. I said it was Bob.
Yeah, well, I got it on tape.
Ball batted out of bounds. It'll still belong to the Warriors. Gulbranson will inbound. This is Talia Baum. Back to Gulbranson. Gulbranson will fire it up. Didn't hit the iron, but it's retrieved by Sanders. Baum, no. And the rebound goes to the Lady Crabbers. 10-5, 2:33 remaining. Bingo, number 34, Weeks. Excuse me, Cruz, rather. Linda Cruz called her Weeks twice. Twice in 1 week, I guess I would say. Sanders, top of the key. Her team up by 3. Bad pass. It was too well telegraphed.
Yeah, you got it. You can't telegraph that pass against the zone.
Back come the Crabbers, trying to make it a 1-point game or even a tie with a 3. Off the glass.
And if you're playing horse, you got to call
yeah.
that.
Tanisha Thomas makes it a one-point difference now, 10-9. Crabbers got it back. And what, was knocked out of bounds by the Warriors.
So the Lady Crabbers maintained it. Was a nice steal on the inbounds pass.
So the Warriors now with a one-point lead, but the Crabbers a three-point attempt off the mark. This is Talia Baum. Spots Gulbranson down the court, and can she hold on to it? No, she cannot.
Couldn't catch up with it.
So now the Crabbers will bring it back, and they can go ahead with a basket. Minute 35 to go in the half. You're watching the Warriors and the Crabbers, the lady version. Recorded for your viewing pleasure here on the 25th of January, 1997. 3 second violation. Tim Cole and Bob Hintz coming to you from Kingitan High School.
Is that the official she gave the dirty look to?
No, that was the other one.
Because she had one little toe in that lane. He called 3 seconds. I said,
you want to be careful what you do or say or even glare at an official, because they have long memories. They have terrible eyesight, but they got long memories.
Oh, you said a little bit like an elephant in a rhinoceros? Bad eyesight, long?
No, I never said that. At the free throw line is Ebony Copeland. She is 2 of 4 from the free throw line so far here in the first half. She'll get two more chances. That's right. Scotty wants to know whether it will cost to erase some of those comments. Copeland gives her team a two-point lead. There you see the story of the game. 1:14 left in the half. Copeland can't get the second one, but Sherman rebounds. Gives to Gulbranson. Yes!
Oh, got to bounce off the rim and the backboard.
So the Warriors back on top by 4 after the three-point play. In the lane, Weeks throws it out. Retrieved by Thomas. Thomas will fire it up from outside. No good. Loose ball, and Sanders comes up with it for the Warriors. Angie Sanders has played a lot here in the first half. Did not start the game, but she's played all of the second quarter. Gulbranson, 22, back to Sanders. Copeland puts the shoulder down, goes to the lane, and draws the foul.
Yeah, number 34, that's Cruz. Linda Cruz just hooked her with her arm, tried to stop her from the drive. I'm impressed with Copeland. She's very aggressive on the offensive end of the floor. You expect him to be real aggressive defensively, but she gets that ball, and if she's got a chance to drive to the basket, she does, and I'm sure that's what Lester Sapp told her. We'll put pressure on the Crabbers right up, and the Crabbers still are not in the 1-1, are they?
Nope. Copeland. So Copeland has hit, missed. So we'll see if the trend continues here. Last time she missed, her teammates got it and put it back in for a three-point play total. And Copeland does the same thing again, only this time it's rebounded by the Lady Crabbers. So she's hit the first one, missed the second one. Of course, like you've said so often, you're the 1-1. You got to hit the first to even get a shot at the second one. Outside, Weeks, or Cruz, rather. I got a mental block on her name. It's Cruz, not Weeks. Gulbranson is open. No. Offensive board by Felicia Kidd doesn't go. 2 seconds. 1 second. And that is the buzzer to end the first period. So the Hampton Crabbers put 4 on the board for a total of 9 at halftime. And the Warriors consistent with 7 in the first, 7 in the second. And they lead at halftime by the score of 14-9. We'll return to Kingitan High School for the third period of action after this brief timeout. There you see our score at halftime, and you're looking at the Hampton Crabber Lady Crabbers, coached by Paula Hines, as they gather their thoughts before the second half. For the Crabbers, they were paced by Linda Cruz with 4 points, 2 baskets. 3 points for Monica Jackson, and she was saddled with some foul problems, so she did not play much in the second period, had a basket and one of two free throws. And Tanisha Thomas had the other 2 points for the Lady Crabbers as they went to the free throw line just twice and hit one of two. For the Warriors, they were paced by Felicia Kidd, who had 5 points. She had a basket and 3 out of 4 from the free throw line. 4 points each for Ebony Copeland, and she did all of that at the free throw line, hitting 4 out of 8. Kim Gulbranson had 4 points on 2 baskets. And 1 point for Eola Lewis on 1 of 2 free throws. And Tonya Sherman did not score in the first half. She was 0-for-4 from the free throw line as the Lady Warriors hit 8 of 18 from the charity stripe. And they lead by 5 here as we get set to start the second half.
Well, Tim, I'm anxious to see when they start the second half whether the Warriors are going to come back out in that box and one when Monica Jackson comes back out if she's starting. They very successful with it, took Hampton really out of their offensive rhythm.
If the standings are the way I understand them to be, this is a very important game for that eighth position in the Peninsula District Tournament. The Kickatan Warriors 3-9, while the Crabbers 3-10, battling for that eighth spot. Warwick is ahead of both of them, as is Heritage, with identical 6-7 records. So this is really a battle for the final position in the upcoming Peninsula District Tournament, which takes place in a couple of weeks. All right, the Warriors will get it on the possession arrow to start the second half, and they immediately turn it over. And down the court, unable to hold on to it, but still in possession, the Lady Crabbers.
Well, and I know there's, they're not playing a box and one on Jackson.
Gulbranson with the rebound for the Lady Warriors.
And Hampton is in a 1-2-2 zone. And I think we got an offensive foul, didn't we?
I had someone walk right in front of me.
Exactly. That time Copeland turned to go to the basket, Tim, but somebody was there. You can't run over him.
But Monica Jackson is back in the lineup. There is the foul, as it was seen. And that would go against Copeland, I believe.
And they're back into that box and one, exactly what they're doing. Brought in Gales.
Felicia Kidd races out of the huddle, throws it back to Sherman.
Well, that was a great job of not only catching the ball, but stopping and not traveling by Sherman.
14-9, the Warriors by 5, and Copeland inside gets her first basket, and she has 6. Largest lead of the game, 7 points for the Lady Warriors. On the baseline, nice feed for Crystal Woods.
Well, Crystal was standing there, nobody picked her up. Great pass. It's almost like a 3-2 zone that Hampton's in. It looks like a 1-2-2, but it's very similar to a 3-2. Putting pressure on the guards.
Again, if you joined us late, there is no shot clock in high school ball, so you can take as long as you like to shoot, as long as you get across the 10-second timeline. The Crabbers do so. Spot the open player, shot just a little too strong. Loose ball, and back come the Warriors with the ball and a 7-point lead.
Well, there's nobody back on the defense when the Crabbers turn around with the ball. Nobody's getting back when they're pressing.
Oh, good hustle. Felicia Kidd just hustled and stole the ball from the Crabber on the baseline, who was just kind of standing there. That's where that hustle pays off. Copeland in traffic is fouled.
That's a tough pass. She's got almost sandwiched between three young ladies, one in the back and one on each side. And Kim Gulbranson, as you see, gets that pass in there. And then she gets slapped around a little bit.
Foul was charged to Akia Smith, number 33. That's her first. And we've got a whistle and a turnover. A little traveling music maestro. Sherman bats the inbound pass back out. Still belongs to the Lady Crabbers. They trail by 7. And here comes Jackson. This is Monica Jackson, saddled with some foul problems, and she turns it over. Felicia Kidd intercepts it.
Well, Felicia Kidd watched the young lady Jackson bring the ball up and then broke into the passing lane at the last second. Great interception that time by Felicia Kidd.
This is Keona Gales and Gulbranson. Outside, pass inside, telegraphed and stolen. This is Monica Jackson, and Jackson will bank it in. So Jackson, good defense, pays off.
Well, they missed her in the first half. Tim, I don't think she played, but maybe half of the first half.
Unofficially, she picked up, I believe, that third foul, which caused Paula Hines to put her on the bench. Back come the Crabbers. Same kind of play that worked a moment ago for the Warriors, but this time ends up in a turnover.
And that time was a great job by Sherman to get the ball, and we had a wild pass there at the end. Sherman not only got the rebound, but got rid of it and threw it to a teammate before she fell down, which would have been a traveling had she hung on to the ball.
4:38 left here in the third. A 5-point difference. The Crabbers trying to get the lead back. Jackson, Reynolds, long rebound, and who touched it last? They say it went off of Felicia Kidd.
We got a lot of traffic in front of us tonight, don't we?
One thing I won't miss here at Kickatan, the hospitality is wonderful, but boy, I tell you, you just got people going back and forth all night long, taking their sweet time. Travers down by 5. About halfway through the third period. Open is Reynolds. She'll put it up. No good. Pair of Travers underneath, and the foul is on Sherman as she got on top of the back of the Lady Crabber. It'll be a player control foul, and it'll belong to the Crabbers at the baseline. Neither team over the limit here in the second period. Pass comes in. Fortunately for the Crabbers, it just glanced off of a Crabber and then ricocheted off of a Warrior. Crabbers get it in, and it's stolen by Copeland. Good hands.
It really was. She just kind of reached in and picked her pocket.
Copeland is starting to top my list of potential candidates for player of the game for the Warriors. Loose ball, scramble for it, and it belongs to the Lady Crabbers on the possession arrow. Watch the replay here. You're going to see. Lucky that the Warrior didn't get a penalty for pushing off.
Really?
She clearly stuck her elbow out there, and then you saw the battle for the ball. Back to the live action. The Crabbers down by 5. Just on the three-point line, rattles it home. So the basket drops, but just inside the three-point line. So Thomas credited with the deuce. .17 left in the third. Warriors up by 3. Down low for Kidd.
Nice catch, Tim, before she put it up.
That was a turning stop.
Tough pass, but she did not only caught it, but gathered herself and made the shot.
Stolen by Sherman. Tonya Sherman wants to go coast to coast, and she does.
And she almost had to do it because she'd have lost control had she not.
Stole the ball and went the length of the floor, and her teammates loved it. They jumped up and gave her a round of applause, and Hampton calls timeout.
That's one of those plays you say, oh, no, give it to a guy. Great shot. Tim, as you mentioned, we will pick a player of the game as we look at two of the Hampton High assistant principals in the stands. We'll pick a player of the game for both teams. They will receive a plaque and a T-shirt as we watch the replay. Nice shot. The plaque comes from Buckwalter Engraving, located at Kickatan Road. For all your engraving needs, contact Jim at 723-6067 Dave Buckwalder is the owner. The shirt comes from the Islander Hardware and Sporting Goods. They are located in Pocosin, and they can meet all your sports needs with a full line of athletic goods, both team and individual, equipment and uniforms, plus screen printing. Call Dave Chubb, 868-8467. John Roberts is owner. We do appreciate their helping us pick one of these young ladies from each of these teams tonight, Tim.
And I understand that these basketball players and football players that we've awarded these to are really appreciative of those plaques and T-shirts. They really wear them proudly and display the plaques.
Well, you know, sometimes the parents call and the parents want to get
sure.
Which is fine. You know, that's great. I'm just glad to see it. Glad
we're glad to do that because we're real happy to recognize outstanding play. We always throw that little disclaimer in there about the lack of any scientific method in choosing our players of the game, but we try to recognize as many of these fine athletes as we can. So it's a pleasure to have these athletes showcased. And a couple of people last week commented to us how they watch the games all the time on Channel 5 and how much the kids appreciate it. And that's what it's all for. It's for these young athletes, both the boys and the girls, to get the recognition. They do a great job, and we're glad we can recognize them. Sherman's shot doesn't go, and a foul on the stick back.
Well, Tim, that's why it's so important to recognize the Islander Hardware and Sporting Goods and Buckwalder Engraving, because they donate these plaques and the shirts. And you look at these plaques, they're neat plaques. Yeah. Really are great. They're wood, they're engraved. And the T-shirts are really something you can just wear at any time, and they're really neat because it says player of the game right on them.
Yeah, well, we encourage our viewers to use these sponsors and buy your plaques and T-shirts from them. Support our sponsors. They do a great job. And these aren't free, folks. These shirts and plaques cost the sponsors money, so patronize them. It'll be something that is worthwhile for everybody. Lewis misses the first of two, and second one won't go either. But the Warriors get the rebound, and they stick it back in with a shot from the corner. Lewis didn't make the free throws, but hit the hard jumper. And the biggest lead of the game, 9 points now, 24. There you see a good look at Lewis. 24-15. Off the glass, too strong, but the
nice
stick
job
back by Cruz. Linda nice. Cruz.
No, it's Crystal Wood, number 20. Oh, it's 34. You're
34.
Right. That's right. And that was that weak side rebound. It's important to rebound, but sometimes the weak side is the one that you've got to be concerned about.
Turnover gives the ball back to the Crabbers. Paula Hines coaching on the far side.
I haven't seen her sit down much.
No, she's an active coach. Her squad down by seven, 24-17, little more than a minute and a half to go in the third. Foul on the shot as Felicia Reynolds will get a pair. She was fouled by Copeland, number 11 for Kickatan. So Reynolds looking for her first points of the ball game, gets two shots. And she makes good on the first. Reminder, we'll have the boys contest coming for you right here on Channel 5. Hampton led by Bobby Blizzard and Ronald Curry. As Reynolds hits both, they'll be taking on Rivas Conrad's Kickatan Warriors, faced by Pierre Lipford, who had 22 points in that heartbreaking double overtime loss the other night to Heritage.
I tell you that Linda, I'm sorry, that Monica Jackson impresses me, Tim. She has got such quickness, but a great job of coaching by Lester Sapp to come out in that box and one.
Oh, yeah. She's got 5 points in the game and basically has been a non-entity. Alicia Kidd's pass is batted out of bounds. Actually, it was Gale that eventually got it, but then it was knocked out of bounds. Still belongs to Kickatan. Contact, no foul. Shot put up, and Sherman should be called for the foul. Is that how it's going to go? Yep.
Yeah, she went over right over the back of Monica Jackson that time.
Watch the replay. You'll see it down low. That could have been a foul there. It wasn't. And here you didn't see but a little bit of it, but it was a good call by the officials.
I think the officials have called a good game. Excuse me, Tim. Yeah. I think they've called a good game because it's not been a pretty game tonight.
They've done a good job. Off the glass gently for Linda Cruz, and it's back to a three-point contest. So every time the Warriors stretch that lead out, the Crabbers will come back with a burst. They're back within three now with a half a minute to go in the third period.
And the Crabbers are in more of a 2-3. And I think they kind of hold it for the last shot. There's less than 18 seconds to go.
Down to 10. And they throw it away. Cruz intercepts it. Had it for a minute, lost it, got it back. Jackson will fire it up short. And back come the Lady Warriors as the buzzer sounds to end the third period. So the difference after two periods was 5 points. And the Crabbers cut into that lead, and we are looking at a 24-21 difference as we've played three. So that time, a much better period for the Crabbers, 12 points, bettering their entire first half output as they outscored Kickitan 12-10 in the third period. You look at some of the crowd in attendance tonight, watching this game and as well to follow. Thomas Mann?
Yeah, oh, Mr. Mann.
He'll be here to watch the Crabbers.
Yes, he will.
Coach on the football team, of course. Crowd still filing in here. As you mentioned, Bob, this game, the only game in the Peninsula District tonight, a makeup game between these two teams, as memory serves as well. Both the Warriors and the Crabbers in postseason play had their football season extended and therefore had their basketball season delayed. As I'm glad they do that. You know, it's not fair to penalize these basketball teams because athletes that played on the football team can't get out there, and it puts you at a huge disadvantage.
It really does.
So the Peninsula District has allotted for that by postponing games early in the basketball season for teams that play through the playoffs in football. Throw it away.
Defensive pressure.
Reynolds is fouled on the way to the basket. That'll be a foul on Kidd. Neither team is in the bonus situation, but they're going to say that she was shooting. A good call. Two shots coming for Felicia Reynolds, who hit her only other two attempts at the free throw line. Angie Sanders will come back in the game. She'll replace Kiona Gales for the Kickitan Lady Warriors. Well, we've enjoyed our three-game stint here at the Kickitan Coliseum. We will be moving on down the road. We'll go down Woodland Road a little ways to Phoebus.
Yeah, go down Woodland, turn on Ireland, and run right into Phoebus High.
Reynolds not able to keep her string going. Got the rebound, and it's saved by the Crabbers. So down by just two now. And put this one up. Off the glass, and good. So we've got a tie ball game. Akia Smith hits it at the 7:17 mark of the fourth quarter, and we're tied at 24. And a reach in and a foul. Oh, that's a tough call.
Yeah, that call looked like it was, she did a great job getting the ball.
What's that old rule? The hand is part of the ball, and if she got the hand and the ball simultaneously, well, let's not beat that horse, but looked like a pretty good defensive play, but the officials saw it differently. Player control foul, so it didn't really cost the Crabbers other than the fact that it looked like they were going to get the ball. Shot is no good. Chased down by Sherman. Good job of getting it to her teammate, and then the ball is blocked as Lewis went up for it, and we've got a foul. This will go against Reynolds. That'll be three on Reynolds.
I tell you, Kickitan is just not getting the good inside shots or the rebounds from missed shots that they were in that first half. And they went from a 9-point lead, Tim, all the way down to a tie. They've given up 9 points in this last, what, about 3 minutes?
And they throw it away. So 6:46 left in regulation time. We can start using that term because we're tied at 24.
Well, and I think what Lester's trying to do is he's trying to draw that Hampton out of that zone, play a man-to-man, and I think he will beat him on the boards on a man-to-man and get some inside shots if he can get him to go man-to-man.
Monica Jackson battles for the ball and then gets fouled in the act of shooting.
She's a real scrapper out there. I'll tell you, they really missed her that first half.
Sanders guilty of the foul. Watch the number 10. Now you're going to see her. Not much contact by Sanders, but she got called for the foul. And Jackson now, with just 5 points in the game, will have a chance for two at the free throw line and a chance for her team to regain the lead. Jackson rattles it in and out.
Got a nice stroke on that ball.
That ball looked like it was going to go down.
Yeah, there was nothing wrong with that shot.
Except it didn't stay down.
Well, yeah. Other than it not going through the hoop, yeah.
Right. That one much less accurate. So
and I don't know that they even hit the rim.
No, that looked like it got nothing but the board. So 0-for-2, and Jackson fails to give her team the lead as she could have. Now the Warriors will try to regain. Sanders is going to pull it back out. Right side for Lewis. Crabbers stacked back in that zone defense. Top of the key and a jump ball. And a possession arrow gives the ball to the Crabbers. So Sherman brought that ball down around her waist. And that's, as you've said, Bob, is a big problem. You don't want to do that.
If you're tall, you keep it up. The only way they're going to get it is to foul you.
So the Crabbers, again, with 6 minutes to go in regulation, with a chance now to take the lead. Weeks. Cruz, Weeks. Why have I got Weeks on my mind here, Bob?
I don't know
why I call her Weeks. It's Cruz. Cruz knocks it out of bounds. It'll still belong to the Warriors. Don't know why I've got that problem. But this is something. This, you know, easier than me to correct myself. Let's change her name.
Well, there you go. I'm sure she wouldn't mind.
I'm sure she would.
Boy, you talk about getting some calls. Call Tim Cole at area code 757.
Oh, no, don't give any phone numbers out there. All right. Sanders brings it across the timeline, still knotted up at 24. Kigatan led after one. They led by 5 at halftime. They led by 3 after 3. But the Crabbers have battled back.
And they're just trying to force the ball in, Tim, where there's no pass.
Akia Smith stole the ball, but then dragged her pivot foot and gives it right back to the Warriors. Gulbrandson has not played much at all here in the second half. You know, she may be under the weather, I'm not sure, but she's usually a mainstay on the floor for Lester Sattler. Not familiar. She doesn't have any fouls that I'm aware of. And contact, and that will be against Smith. That'll be her second. And that is going to be a non-shooting foul, as Hampton is in the bonus, but Kikitan is not here in the second half. Have to be on your 7th team foul, the bonus becomes effect. That is Sherman with the stick.
Offensive rebound.
Tonya Sherman gives Kigatan a 2-point lead. Grabbers, Cruz drives the lane, won't go down, but she'll get a couple of shots. Both teams now are over the limit. Foul is called against number 11, Copeland. That's her third. There you see at the free throw line is Linda Cruz. She had 4 in the first half. She's got 4 here in the second. Chance, if she can hit these free throws, to give herself double digits for the game. 4:42 remaining in regulation time. And she hits the first. Crabbers have only took 2 free throws in the first half. They have taken 7 here in the second half. Yes, if you looked at it from the Crabbers' point of view, you would say, gee, the whistles haven't gone our way, because in the first half, Binghamton had 18 attempts from the free throw line.
Well, I think it was the over-aggressiveness of the Crabber defense that caused those fouls.
Oh, heavily down, and that should be a block, and it's a good call by the official.
I tell you, the young lady really hit her, Linda Cruz, hit her head, Tim, when she came down right directly in front of us.
I'm telling you, she bounces right back up, to her credit. That was a tough contact to take.
It really was. She got there, but she didn't get there quite soon enough. Watch
this, coming right at you here.
And she kept right on sliding in as Felicia Kidd got there, but not lack of effort.
She will have a headache later on tonight, folks. She's had one all game. She's glared at the referees a couple of times. All right, Felicia Kidd unable to capitalize at the free throw line, and it remains a one-point difference. Hampton now with a three-point attempt off the mark, and Kidd with the rebound quickly, and a reach-in.
Tim, that was really a good foul, because
yeah,
if she did, it was three Kickatan Warriors going down. They're going to get a layup or a putback.
Yep, that was an excellent foul. It'll make Kidd go to the free throw line and earn the points.
And that was on who?
That was a reach-in by Thomas, I believe.
Yeah, number 23? Okay.
Yeah. I think it was 23.
Yeah, I believe it was.
Good foul. So give them the 1-1 instead of a pretty confident layup. And Kidd is able to connect on this one.
Well, and Tim, she missed the front end of that 1-1 last time. And as you heard me say many times, that 1-1 is so important, because if you don't, you never get a chance to get two if you don't get that first one.
So Kidd will get the bonus now. And she hits it. So she hits two in a row and gives her team a three-point margin. 4-12 left in regulation. Hampton down by three. Cruz tries to save it, but she threw it out of bounds, and they'll give the ball to Kickatan. Full court pressure being applied by the Lady Crabbers. Sanders gets it across the timeline, can't hold on to it, however, and the loose ball is taken at the baseline by Reynolds. Felicia Reynolds drives the lane, put it up, no good. Too strong off the glass, and Felicia Kidd brings it down, and she turns it over.
Yes, they gotta catch the ball. They're just having trouble catching the ball, the Warriors.
3.5 to go. Cruz in the lane, put it up, no good. And the rebound comes to Felicia Kidd. Players of the game still to be announced. Sherman, baseline, no good. And then she reached over. Let's see if they call it that way.
Yeah.
Yep, they do.
She tried to guide the ball in instead of just shoot it. Happens sometimes.
So what one time.
You give up two you should have had, you give the Hampton a chance to get two, and Lester Sapp says, we need to talk this thing over.
So the Crabbers, with a timeout called by Kickatan, or is it Hampton? Now they've charged the timeout too, I believe. Not sure. I think the official's going to go over and double check that to see who called the timeout. It was.
I don't know. Buddy's giving us two signals.
Well, he did like he used to do when he was the coach down at third base. He gave us about four signals.
Well, I was getting ready to steal.
I was going to say, ready either steal or bunt. I'm not sure which.
Maybe it was a hit and run.
Maybe.
Anyway, the players we're considering player of the game right now for the Kickatan. Of course, you got to look at Sherman and Copeland, who you have mentioned before. Gales is doing a great job defensively, Tim. She is keeping Monica Jackson out of her offense, and that's a very important thing. Felicia Kidd is playing a great job. You go on the other side, Jackson and Reynolds and Cruz, just to mention a few who we're leaning towards right now, but there are many good players out there. This is very unscientific. This is a good shot of Connie Sapp, Lester's wife, there in the gold sweater.
28-25 with 3:17 remaining in regulation. you're enjoying this contest between the Lady Crabbers and the Lady Warriors. Tim Cole and Bob Hintz coming to you from Kickatan High School on the 25th of January. You know there's only 11 more months till Christmas, Bob? Right after the 1-1, Linda Cruz cuts that lead down to just 2. There you see it. Get the second one to drop. Sherman got the rebound. Her team brings it up by 2. And Sanders goes down heavily, and she cannot control it on the baseline. Give it back to the Crabbers.
But a couple shots in, she's just having trouble catching the ball. She's got to concentrate and look at that ball into her hands. And she's right now, Angie's the one that's staying all over Monica Jackson.
In the lane, off the glass. Tanisha Thomas. And we're tied at 28 and a foul in the backcourt. That one goes against Thomas.
And she's not too sure about that shot. It was a nice shot, but she's not too sure about that foul.
So the free throw is becoming ever more important here as we're tied at 28. We're down to 2:46. Their record's almost identical and the score almost the same. It's been a very close game throughout, although Kickatan did lead by 9.
Good shot of
Gulbertson back in the game as she had been on the bench for a good part of the second half.
And got that first one, Tim, with that 1-1.
There you see a good look at Kim Gulbertson. Chance to give her team a 2-point lead here. Concentrating. And it rims out. So a 1-point difference. Lady Crabbers, 2:40 to go. Cruz gives back out to Reynolds. Reynolds for 3, no. And Reynolds aggressively gets the loose ball.
And you're right, that was aggressively.
Monica Jackson off the mark.
She's getting frustrated.
Felicia Kidd. Felicia Kidd switches hands on the dribble. Good play by Felicia Kidd. And then a reach in by Reynolds. Just a little too aggressive. That'll cost her. That'll be, I believe, her 5th. Yep, that's all on Reynolds.
Man.
So Reynolds played good aggressive ball. Both of these two teams have played real well on defense. They've really rattle the other team. At the free throw line, check that, start to say Lewis, that's Copeland, 11, not 31. And shots coming.
Yes, 2 shots are out of the, they're in a double bonus, basically, right. what they're over at 10 fouls.
All right, so that takes some of the pressure off
of it. It really does.
You get 2 automatically once your team has been called for 10, and she doesn't need the extra help as she hits it. That's Copeland's first.
But that makes that first shot so much easier.
Oh, yeah.
You can really relax. There's no tension on you. You want to make it, but you don't have to make it to get the next try.
Copeland hit 4 out of 8 in the first half. That's her first visit to the free throw line. And Sherman, I believe, traveled, yes.
She went up and came back down.
And believe it or not, it took all the way to the last 2 minutes of the fourth quarter for Copeland to come back in and continue her pattern of hitting the first one and missing the second. She's 5 out of 10, and she's hit the first and missed the second all night. 2-point game. And the pass was not expected by Cruz. It surprised her down low. Felicia Kidd spots Sherman. Got it.
Oh, what a nice pass and catch.
Sherman from Kidd. And that's a 4-point lead now with a 1:40 to go. In the lane, Jackson kisses it off the glass.
One of the very few times she's got the ball tonight.
Felicia Kidd through heavy traffic. Kicks it back. This time it's Copeland from the free throw line. Short, Gulbertson had it knocked away. Gulbertson saves it. 1:20 in the lane, a foul, and that one will go against 23, Thomas.
I think 33 made the foul, but oh, Thomas is not happy at all.
And that'll be all on number 23, if that's the correct person called for the foul. Tanisha Thomas.
Well, I thought Kim was going to get got fouled a couple times there. Goberson, she looked like she was knocked down, but no call.
So Keisha Anderson, 32 now, will check in, replacing the player who had fouled out, Thomas. And Ebony Copeland, who has hit every other free throw, will get two tries here with a two-point lead for her team. Very important free throws with a minute 19 remaining. And she breaks her string of alternating completed free throws. And she knows how important that one was. There you see a real good look on her face. Intense. Can't get it to drop. So the Crabbers down by two. Anderson just in the game. This is Cruz. And we got a travel before the shot. That was a good call.
She did. She shuffled her feet.
Referee Robert Dixon quick to call it. That was an excellent call. Bad call for the Crabbers because that was a basket that would have tied the game. We're down to less than a minute now. Sanders can't hold it. The ball is kicked into the backcourt. A race to the ball. A good job by Sanders just to impede. Oh, now they say no. Now they're going to be an overruling.
He wasn't sure.
Yep. So what are they going to call now? They're going to give it to the Warriors.
That was a good job of two officials working together.
And that was a good job by Sanders, who couldn't get to the ball, but she just slowed herself down so that she prevented the Crabber from getting to the ball.
Yeah.
And a timeout is called by the Warriors as they want to set this up now with 44 seconds remaining and a two-point lead for the Warriors, and they'll have the ball at midcourt. So this has been an exciting contest. Hope you've enjoyed it here on Channel 5. We'll have our next contest will be Tuesday night. That's when we'll play the game on the 28th at Phoebus High School as the Hampton Crabbers will be there. And we hope you will be out there to support your favorite team. Please support these athletes. They work hard.
No. No, it's Bethel.
Oh, is it Bethel and Phoebus?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Phoebus.
That's the last game of the season.
Yeah. Phoebus and Hampton is the 7th of February. That's our last regularly scheduled contest.
All right. Bethel and Phoebus, come on out.
I was talking to Bill Wessels, who's refereeing the second game. He says last night over at Bethel, when Bethel played Minchville and beat him, he says there was not a seat in that gym. He said that was, you talk about a great game in a packed house. He said it was a great contest.
These referees like to do those kind of contests too. They like those big games. We talked about it in football, same thing in basketball. They like to play or referee the games where there's a lot on the line. All right, the Warriors up by a pair. Gulbranson spots Sherman underneath, put it in. No, it won't stay down. Knocked out of bounds. Who did it?
Wow, what a nice pass by Gulbranson to get it inside. And Sherman just couldn't get it to go down.
Warriors keep possession. Copeland in the lane, running one-hander. Yes!
Whoa! That's a big basket, Tim. Two possessions now.
Ebony Copeland. Cruz, no, but she is fouled. Cruz will go to the free throw line. Here's the replay. Watch as Cruz pulls up, and then Gulbranson just reached in and got her on the arm.
Just really, really smacked her.
Yeah, I mean, just clear as the nose on your face. Two shots coming, both teams over the limit, but that would have been two shots in any event.
Well, she's got to make one of these to cut it to a one possession for the Hampton Crabbers.
Cruz misses the first of two. 19 seconds remaining. Linda Cruz at the free throw line. Short. Chased down in the corner by Felicia Kidd, and they call her for traveling. That's a terrible call.
She got a little help.
Well, she sure did. as in pushed from behind. She never had control of the ball. You know, you have to have control to be called for travel. From three-point land off the heel of the rim, Sanders has the rebound, gets back to Kidd, and Kidd is fouled on the reach-in. I tell you, Kidd is tough.
She is a tough young lady.
She is taking some hard knocks here in the ball game, and she has come down hard. But she bounces right back up with 9 seconds to go. Watch this now. You're going to see right here that Jackson just kind of cut in front of her and knocked her down. But look at her. She's on the floor. She says, that's all right. We get the ball. We get to shoot. I like this. That's the kind of competitive spirit you love to see.
But you do want to mention who we're going to pick for the player of the game. We're going to go with Ebony Copeland from the Kickatan Warriors. Put that last shot in, but she's done a great job all night. I don't know how many points she's got, Tim. You've got it there.
Well, she had 4 in the first half, and she's added 5 here. So she's got 9 unofficially in the ball game. But it's not so much her points. And Felicia Kidd has played an excellent game,
too.
Yes,
she has.
She got our first game Player of the Game award,
that's
I believe. But in any event, Ebony Copeland. And certainly a case could be made for Tonya Sherman, Felicia Kidd, and for that matter, Yola Lewis. But Copeland is our player of the game. And on the other side?
On the other side, we're going to go with the young lady you had trouble with her name.
Linda Weeks.
No, I think it's Cruz.
She has 10 points unofficially in the game. But again, her contribution is not just the points, but her overall hustle. Back in the game for the Lady Crabbers, Ebony Jackson, the starter, but has not seen a lot of action tonight. Interestingly, neither did Akia Smith. Neither one of them saw a lot of action, even though they were starters. Felicia Kidd, no good. Loose ball, and it's retrieved by the Lady Crabbers, down by 4. 3 seconds to go. The Warriors say, fine, shoot, go ahead, no problem. So the Warriors hold on and beat the Hampton Crabbers by the final score of 34-30. And a very hard-fought game. And you can see Lester Sapp's squad is starting to enjoy the aspect of winning.
Yeah, well, ain't a whole lot anything better than winning a ball game.
It's
a whole lot better than the alternative.
Beat Heritage last night, 49-32. And hold on to beat a game Hampton team by the final score of 34-30. So our players of the game, Copeland from Kickatan and Cruz from Hampton. So for Bob Hintz and the entire Channel 5 crew, this is Tim Cole. Thanks for watching.
You think they're not happy yet?
They're happy. They're doing a warrior dance.
And we do want to thank our one sponsor,
Woodfield Home, with Richard Pulley, the field director. 34-30, our final score. Good night, everybody.
About 8 minutes.